Dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for attending today's event on this very lovely evening on the last day of beautiful May. Tomorrow we will start our summer season. I would like to express my gratitude to the Korean Commercial Arbitration Board and the Korean Council for International Arbitration, KOSIA, for hosting today's lecture along with Seoul IDRC. As you know well, Seoul IDRC is a hearing facility dedicated to international arbitration. Seoul IDRC has been hosting various seminars and lectures to promote international arbitration. The Seoul IDRC lecture series is one of our key events program where we introduce leading international arbitration practitioners to those in Korea interested in international arbitration. Today, I have the honor of presenting Dr. Michael Pang, Senior Counsel of Supreme Court of Singapore, as a guest lecturer. He concurrently served as non-resident Chief Justice of the Dubai International Financial Center, DIFC, Courts. Michael was a partner in Allen & Gladfield and served as the head of its litigation and arbitration department for 10 years, which is more than 40 years of distinguished professional career. He has served in various capacities, including Judicial Commissioner of the Supreme Court of Singapore, Singapore's Ambassador to Switzerland and Argentina, President of the Law Society of Singapore, Commissioner of the United Nations Compensation Commission, Vice Chairman of the ICC International Court of Arbitration, Vice President of the International Council for Commercial Arbitration, ICA, Board Member of the London Court of International Arbitration, and Board Member of Swiss Arbitration Association, to name only a very few. We are very grateful that Michael serves as a member of Seoul IDRC's International Advisory Board. Today, Michael will talk on the issue of advocacy in the commercial arbitration. For arbitration counsels, it is crucial to deliver his or her arguments effectively and clearly to the tribunal in a convincing manner. We are very lucky today to have Michael share his extensive experience and insight on the issue of advocacy in commercial arbitration. Please join me in welcoming Michael with big hands.
It's good to be back in Seoul again, particularly on such a nice day. These days I'm better known as an international arbitrator, but I have been had a long career as a litigator, probably for 3.5 decades before I started to focus on changing the direction of my practice into sitting as a judge and an arbitrator. So I'm sharing some of my thoughts which have crystallized over the years, and in particular the last 5 years or so. So I'm giving you benefit of my views from both sides of the bar, as it were. Now, the whole idea of this is to see, for commercial arbitration, what kind of advocacy works best with the run of commercial arbitration tribunals. Now, I have this theory, which is encapsulated in the title of the talk, which is focused around the importance of the opening statement versus the benefits, perceived benefits of cross-examination. And let's start from some basic observations. And I emphasize again, I'm not saying that cross-examination is useless or not beneficial in all cases. We'll come to that in a minute, but what I'm talking about is commercial arbitration, international commercial arbitration. And commercial cases normally arise from a contract. You have to have a contract in order to have an arbitration agreement, and the cause of action will, in 90% of the cases, mainly be based on the contract. Of course, you can have claims that arise out of the contract. So you may have tortious claims or delictual claims that are incidental to a contractual dispute. The best example, of course, is that suing on a contract, there is a defense of misrepresentation, and that might become the tort in itself, and that will require some special approach for advocacy. But by and large, the issues are contractual. Now, but whether it is civil law or common law, contractual liability normally, the starting point is that you have strict liability. It is not like other civil wrongs, which are based on right and wrong, fault. So the contractual liability normally is a no-fault game. And therefore, the main issue, at least the starting point for a contractual claim, is to construe the contract. And at the bottom line is this question. First, you have to find out what actually happened. Having determined what actually happened, then you just have to, the tribunal needs to examine how did the parties agree in the contract for the loss that has actually happened. If you assume that damage has resulted by certain acts, it doesn't necessarily mean that the person who actually perpetrated the act is going to be liable, because it is all a question of what did the parties agree. So it is called allocation for loss. That's why the interpretation of the contract is so important in commercial contractual cases. And in the average contractual dispute, there are many undisputed facts because the transaction builds up from the contract, and normally most contracts will not go wrong until a certain point in time. So there will be a history of the dispute where things which happen are not going to be in dispute until you get to the contentious part leading up to the events that give rise to the claim, at which point there might be certain disputes about fact. And the other feature about contractual disputes is that there will usually be many documents. You contrast that with criminal cases, you contrast that with your average court case. Typically, of course, the accident case on the road, there are very little documents, obviously, for an accident case. There are relatively few documents for most criminal cases. True blue, mainstream crime, which are, you know, theft, violence, and so on. Commercial fraud, commercial crime, that's a different story. But in the average contractual dispute, there will be documents generated. Many of these documents will have contractual consequence. There again, the question is interpretation first and fact investigation later. So in that scenario, the task of the advocate is to make sense of the documents that are given to you against the background of the facts that you are briefed on. And then you argue a case for liability based mainly on the documents rather than the oral testimony of the witnesses. Now, I have two rules here. The first rule is, the more documents there are in a case, the less the need for cross-examination. And the second rule is, the more relevant documents there are, because very often you can have a mass of documents, particularly in building contract cases, 90% of which may not actually be any use at all. Somebody, some junior associate in the firm is going to sift out all of that, and then you identify what are the relevant documents. And then for the benefit of the tribunal, you still have an irreducible core of documents left to deal with and to explain to the tribunal. And the second rule is, the more relevant documents there are, the greater the need for counsel to take the tribunal through the documents to explain where they fit into this theory of the case. I don't know how advocates in Korea are educated, but in the common law world, we are always taught, when you have to sit down and work out how to argue a case, you have to have a theory of the case. You know all of the facts, and you will have done your research in the law. And you have to plan out, how am I going to present this case to the tribunal, to the court, identifying what the relevant facts are that are in our favor or that we have to prove, and then fit it into a theory, first of fact and then of law, combine the facts with the law and says, because you have these facts which we are going to prove or can prove, and because of the law as we understand it, you arrive at this final solution, which is liability in favor of our client, or whatever the belief is this that you want to claim. Now, I'm not alone in this skepticism about where cross-examination takes you in relation to the theory of the case. You know that in England and Wales, the head of the whole judicial hierarchy is a person called the President of the Supreme Court of England and Wales, what used to be the House of Lords. The current president is a man called Lord Neuberger. Now, this year, in February, Lord Neuberger made a speech. And in that speech, he said, the best points from cross-examination can actually be made more shortly in argument. So what he's saying is, trying to extract facts from cross-examination in order to fit it into your theory of the case is not so efficient. And I'm going to, I hope, demonstrate why. Of course, you know that cross-examination is supposed to be a very distinctive feature of common law tradition, and that's what makes it different from civil law traditions and procedures. But even in common law countries, many commercial cases can be heard without cross-examination if there's no serious dispute of facts. Of course, you need a factual basis in order to be able to arrive at the theory of the case and to argue for the result that comes out of the proven facts. But many facts can be proved, A, by documents, and B, by a witness statement that links the documents and sets out certain facts which are not seriously disputed. In the common law tradition, when you have the rules of the court in trials, in court hearings, there are two types of ways that you can start a case. One is when you know that the facts are going to be heavily contested. And that goes into one channel, if you like. The forms are different. And you will file what we call a statement of the case. And then you will, in due course, file affidavits or witness statements. And then you expect that with the witness statements, you will go to trial, and there will be cross-examination, and then you will get a result. But there are many other types where counsel analyze the case in advance. See, this is actually a genuine commercial dispute, which is not fact-heavy. It is not seriously disputed what the main facts are. And such disputes that there are, well, we'll just put it out there, and we'll put in the documentary evidence that we think the court or the tribunal will be able to come to a conclusion without necessarily having cross-examination. Typically, where the cases turn more on the interpretation of the contract than on the he said, I said kind of dispute. So even within court procedures, common law courts do accept that there are cases that can be heard without having witnesses come for cross-examination. Typically, you do it, for example, with, let's say, all the Companies Act kind of disputes, which tend to be documents, and you are applying for some particular relief under the Companies Act. For example, you want to apply for a reduction of capital. The facts are all very straightforward. You'll show your balance sheet, you show that you've lost money over a certain number of years. There will be some creditors who are objecting. The creditors will file their position statements. They will say, well, they owe us money, and we think that they have more money, or we think that there is a better solution. I mean, these are all arguments that can be made, but you don't need really witnesses to deal with that issue. I'll tell you a story a bit later on, that you can even get quite contentious matters in companies' disputes, which still don't need cross-examination, because sometimes the facts just speak for themselves because of the documentary evidence. There are documents which turn simply on the interpretation of contracts. This is what the contract is. There are two parties, and they can't agree on the interpretation. They just say, well, we'll go to court. We don't need to call the witnesses. This is what the parties have entered into. We say that that entitles us to a certain kind of relief. The other party says no. But you don't really need to cross-examine the witness. So, where you do not have to tell the story through the mouths of witnesses, you should try and avoid this. And let the witness statements tell the story. So I distinguish between written witness statements and oral testimony. The oral testimony is the one that really needs cross-examination. And when you need it, I'll come to that in a minute. As a result of this realization, the more experienced counsel in common law countries are tending to put in much fuller opening statements to explain all the facts, all the issues, nearly all of the important documents to the court right at the beginning of the trial, and then to use the witnesses simply to clarify things which are uncertain, and maybe to extract information. And sometimes, but in a fairly selective way, to try and get witnesses to make either concessions or to admit that they have made errors in their witness statement. And in the old days, what used to happen is everybody tries to keep their case theory very close to their chest until the end of the trial. Mainly because in the old days when we used to have trials in Singapore, nobody had to put anything down in writing much. You would start with your statement of case, and you put in maybe 5 pages, 10 pages. And yet the other side would file a defense. And the way that we were used to be taught to file a defense is that in a defense, all you do is to deny what you want to deny. You don't have to say anything more, so that they don't know what exactly your defense is. You keep them in the dark as long as you can. And so the defense can be 2 pages, 3 pages, because all you have to say is paragraph 1, not admitted, paragraph 2, denied, paragraph 3, we don't know, and so on. So you never really get an idea, and that fulfills. They say, you have to prove everything. And when you start to prove, then we will counterattack. And nobody knew, because nobody had to have witness statements. Witness statements was not, was unknown in the old days. Even in England, I mean, that was what we inherited from the English system. So until the trial starts, nobody knew what the witnesses were going to say. You don't even know which witnesses were coming. Then on day one, suddenly this, well, this is my first witness. Nobody has heard of him. What's he doing here? You will find out when he speaks. And then you can cross-examine. Of course, you don't have time to prepare, and so the things can go off track, as it were. Somebody will say, no, I need more time. Suddenly, this is something completely new. I had no notice of this. It was not efficient. So everybody tried to keep their best cards in. And then they said, okay, everything, after we've heard all the evidence, then we'll come back and we'll then give you what our theory of the case is. I quote a person there called Mr. V.K. Raja. V.K. Raja is one of the most outstanding lawyers in Singapore. He was a senior counsel, like me, and he became a judge. He became our attorney general. And he was one of the outstanding advocates. And in the old days, when both of us had not become judges, we were talking about technique. And, you know, I sort of discussed with him the traditional practice of keeping back your best for last. And he said, you know, I have a different view. And you see my quotation there. He says, when I write my opening statement, I write it as if it's my closing statement. So if you just think about, let's say, the average five-day trial. Says, on Monday, I'm there, I'm ready to argue my full case, like, you know, everything is on the table. And then I push the burden onto the other side to defend. And so Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, they should be defending. And then Friday, I just come in and wrap up. Now, the idea behind this is that you want to achieve some credibility to the court. You, the counsel, are going to the court. If on day one you show that you know the entire case, and you know exactly, of course, what your own case is, and you tell the judge, this is my entire case, and you say, I also analyzed my opponent's case, and this is what's wrong with this case, and maybe some of the matters here are the matters which are in doubt or that need to be clarified by the witnesses. You put those aside, you identify maybe half a dozen areas of dispute. But he says, apart from all of that, look at the documents. Look at this document, that document, and a few others. And they can't run away from this. And if they can't run away from this, tell the judge quite early that they can't run away from it. So you throw the burden onto the other side. And it works the other way. If the claimant is very wishy-washy in his opening, and just says, well, this is the broad strokes of my claim, and broadly speaking, you know, my first witness will prove X, Y, Z, but I'll leave the details to him to explain. Then the respondent's counsel, when he stands up, he says, well, he hasn't bothered to get down to the details. Look at this, what his witness said in his witness statement. Look at my witness statement in reply. Let's analyze the differences. Let's analyze which one is the more credible. And you know, you tackle this straight on. And the judge, if he finds that whichever side is more impressive, he's going to bear that in mind for the rest of the trial. So let's go on and understand why is this approach and the focus on opening statement is logical. This is because the way that the practice of presentation of cases in international arbitration has standardized over the years, and more or less everybody is playing the game by the general rules that are in play with ICC, SIAC, LCIA, and so on, and all the major institutions. And the formats in the different major arbitration institutions are very broadly similar. They all call for full pleadings, full statements of case, full defenses. And the most important thing is that the statement of claim now requires all relevant documents to be attached. So instead of having 10 pages like we did in the old days, you get 50 pages maybe on average of the statement of claim. And then, you know, sometimes one arch legal file of attachments and documents, and the respondent obviously has to reply in the same way. And therefore, and you go on with the witness statements, which will again have all of the documents that the witness wants to rely on attached to their witness statements. And the end result is that there should be relatively few surprises at the trial. Where the parties are in disagreement, those should already be identified long before the hearing. Because all the oral evidence has been reduced to the written statements, the witness statements. And all the documents that are relied on are going to be in the hearing bundles. In fact, there will be more hearing bundles than there are documents that we'll be referring to at the hearing. And of course, that's the task of the counsel. Again, if I go back to the old days to compare with when I started practice, this is due to technology. In the old days, when I first started, when I walked into the office, somebody said, there is a new machine that we have just purchased. It's called the photocopier. Now, before that, we had no photocopier. Now, you want to prepare documents for trial. You take the letter that your client brings to you. All right, this is the letter you wrote. Then your typist copies, copy types. And then you make so many copies. And you make it by carbon. We didn't have the photocopier first. So you do not have a lot of documents because you have to choose very carefully what you want your typist to type. People used to write short letters. And so your hearing bundles are like this. And so the judge will read every page before he goes into the hearing. Now, no tribunal can read every document in the hearing bundles. They can't even read all the documents in the core bundles. So that's why the counsel's job is so important now. But it's all there. The material is all there. So, and don't forget, psychologically, because the tribunal simply cannot read all of the documents in the hearing bundles, the best they can do is to read, obviously, the pleadings, the witness statements, the opening statements, and they're doing well if they can finish all of that and the attachments. They're certainly not going to read any of the other documents in the hearing bundles, which may be important. That is the moment, day one, Monday morning at 10 a.m., when you have the tribunal's undivided attention to the first person who's going to say, I'm going to make sense of all of this for you. And they're going to be so grateful to you if you can do that. Well, whichever side you're on, of course, it's like tennis. The claimant's lawyer, he's the server, so he has that first advantage. And if he gives up that advantage, then I don't think he's doing the best job he can for his client. See, this is what we call the blank easel theory. You go in there, actually all you see is a blank. And then counsel is just painting a picture for the tribunal to look at. Now, what then is the point about the closing statement? So what you're supposed to be doing is that on day one, you say, all right, you've read our pleading, you've read our memorials, you've read our opening statements, and now I'm going to take you through the opening statements. I mean, the opening statements should already have set up the theory of the case very clearly, and it has to deal with what the arguments of the other side are. And to say already, I can tell you now why you should prefer our case to the case of the other side. When you then stand up, then you have to say, I will make good what we have said in the opening statement, the written opening statement. And then you take them through the documents, document by document by document. And then you are building up the story. And that is the art of the counsel, to build up the combination of, look at this witness statement, it explains the sequence of events, it explains the history of the relationship with the parties. Then look at this document, which is the key contractual document and what we're suing on. Look at these clauses. These are the ones that we're going to be relying on. Then go and look at some other witness statement that tells you something happened and this is why the parties now are in disagreement. And look at what was written at the time. This is what one party said. The other party didn't reply. They didn't say anything. Those are the things that you emphasize. Those are the things that don't easily, don't necessarily get noticed by the tribunal when they're found through many, many documents. Or look at their reply. How do they deal with our allegation in paragraph 2? This is their answer in their paragraph 4. You compare paragraph to paragraph 4, whose is more credible? And you go on and it's like this, you do it. And everything kind of is in place. So it's like a jigsaw puzzle. You're putting together the jigsaw puzzle to make the big picture for the tribunal. And you do it sort of, you know, piecemeal, and you build up that picture. And if you're good at it, then, you know, the tribunal will be impressed. But, and then, of course, the witnesses come. But by that time, if you have properly explained the whole theory of the case and you've gone through the documents in detail, then there will be certain, I won't say necessarily gaps, because all the gaps will be covered by the conflicting witness statements. Then you have to deal with the conflicts between what witness A says on your side and what witness B says on their side, and then there will be a little bit of cross-examination. But you tell them in advance, look, there are these areas. You pay attention to these areas and listen, and I'm only going to cross-examine the other side's witnesses in these areas because these are the only material differences. Then, of course, you have to do your cross-examination. And then, when the time comes at the end, you clean up and you say, all right, on day one, this is what I told you, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, that's what our case was. Since then, you've heard the witnesses, how has my case changed? It has changed in the following ways. Right? Witness A has come, we think witness A has confirmed our story, we think witness B was terrible on cross-examination, so that gap is closed, or that doubt has been ironed over. Maybe some things have come out that you didn't expect, then you just have to come back and fit that uncomfortable fact into the theory of the case and say, okay, it's true that we had a concession to make here that may affect our claim in some way, or we have another answer here. But you have to deal with this up front. But the point is that you would not be restating your whole case again on the Friday. You would only be dealing with whatever has happened between Monday and Friday. You emphasize the facts, you face the bad facts, and just say, at the end of the day, our theory is still better than their theory. And that's how you have to try and run the case. Now, unfortunately, that's not the way that counsel have been cross-examining in practice. And I'm afraid that the people who invented the art of cross-examination, the common lawyers, are actually the worst practitioners of the art these days. Sometimes civil lawyers are actually better because they have a better focus on what is important, and they confine their cross-examination to what they think is really important. But I tested my theory in this way. You sit with colleagues usually, and then you listen to the witnesses. The witness comes and he gets cross-examined, then he leaves the room. And during the break, I will sit down over coffee with my co-arbitrator and say, how much do you think you learned out of that cross-examination? And hardly at all do they say, oh, that was a really important cross-examination. You should say, no, not much. I mean, I knew that already. I mean, it was already there. Only thing is that you see, you know, you put a face to the words, but you can't run away from the words because the words, again, are usually backed up by documents. I'm going to run through this pretty quickly because I can go on at this ad nauseam. Some years ago, I wrote an article for 10 questions not to ask cross-examination. So after, you know, about a bit sort of tired of listening to the same ineffective questions, in my view, so I identified 10 questions which repeated themselves. So I wrote this article. And then, having to listen to more ineffective cross-examination over the years, then the list increased to 15. Currently, I've got a list of 21. And I have got the benefit, I mean, you will get the benefit of this, which is attached at the end of the slides, which I'm not going to take you through. But I'm just broadly speaking, I've broken them down into 7 categories. First of all, people try to cross-examine to demonstrate facts which you can show from the documents. And most important, the documents are not challenged. If they're not challenged, you just straight away address the tribunal and say, look at this document, this is what it says. There's nothing in the pleadings to say that they deny that this letter is inaccurate. They don't say that it's inaccurate. So that's a fact, unless they stand up now and say something else. And you don't need to do this. Second is, I told you that the essential issue about a contract is actually the meaning of either the contract itself, sometimes of letters which are written. But if the letter is written, then the words speak for themselves. And you try and get a witness to agree what the letter says. But everybody can see what the letter says. It's bad enough that they try and cross-examine the person who wrote and say, what did you mean by it? But it doesn't matter what the person meant by it. What matters is what the reader understood by it. Because that's really the objective theory. And you are just, how shall I put it, if you are cross-examining a witness about what he intended when he wrote something in the letter, you're just giving him another opportunity to explain away a bad letter. You usually try to do this when the letter is questionable or puts the writer in a bad light. And you can just say so. Look at this letter. This is what he says. This is what he doesn't say. And it is no point in cross-examining this when you've already got it, the benefit of it in your hands, which is letter A was written, saying something, making an allegation against this witness. And in his reply, he never addressed it. And he says, well, look at your letter. Where do you say, or where do you deny that this event took place? Of course, it's not there. And the guy says, well, he'll look, you know, high and low. It takes 2 minutes to look through just in case there's something that he can find. And he wasted that time. And he says, why do we go through with this? He doesn't deny writing that letter. He has not made an excuse. If he wants to make an excuse, then you can challenge him on the excuse. If he doesn't make an excuse, why give him a chance to make an excuse now? So, matters of interpretation, the answer lies in counsel's own hands. He can take hold of the letter and say, this is my interpretation. Any sensible person would interpret it in this way. You don't have to give the witness another chance. But he just wants to make the trouble is many counsel, they think that every time a witness comes, their object must be to make this witness look bad. You can make a witness look bad on small things. It's not the small things which win the case. It's the big things. And the big things must be in the context of the big picture. So you should always be focusing on the big picture and not little parts of it. Because it distorts the proportionality of certain things. The third class of cases which are useless questions are when the witness wants to argue with the witness, and in particular on a legal position. Now I have a view that I don't allow that kind of question. When you ask a witness, even though he's the chief executive of one of the parties, as to, is this the legal position you're taking? Now we say no. Factual witnesses are there for facts. Legal positions are a matter for the counsel. This is the matter that you should challenge the counsel on. This is for the counsel to explain and to be questioned. And that's where you get the legal argument. I don't think it's fair because the client just goes to his lawyer and says, this is the facts. You tell me what's the best case. He's not expected to understand the finer points of contractual relief or contractual liability or responsibility for the acts of third parties and so on. These are all technical legal questions. And he doesn't have the necessary expertise. Right? The fourth class is arguing with the witness on his opinions. There's a technical rule in evidence, which of course doesn't apply in arbitration because there are no rules of evidence, but these rules are there for a reason. Witnesses are there only to testify as to facts. Their opinions don't matter. And there's a lot of arguing about would you agree that this was a reasonable position to take? Or you behaved in an unreasonable manner. What's the point of it? All he has to do is to answer what he actually did. It's for then for the counsel to say, in the circumstances, I am submitting that what he did is reasonable, not reasonable, or whatever other characterization you want to make. If in fact the characterization is relevant at all, because going back to the principle that liability in contract is strict. So either you comply with the contract or you didn't comply with the contract. But sometimes, of course, there are justifications. Then that kind of cross-examination becomes relevant. Now, then there's this issue about credibility. Now, in common law courts, common law judges are a little bit generous. You are allowed to cross-examine a witness on anything he knows about the case, even if he doesn't mention it in his witness statement. But then sometimes they stray. The judge will say, what has this got to do with the case? Because you are asking him about another company that he was involved in. Now, what counsel sometimes wants to do is to show, for example, that this witness was involved in a transaction or in a company that had nothing to do with this particular dispute or this particular party. But when he incorporated that company or he filed some documents, he told something that was untrue or he behaved in a bad way. So it's pure prejudice that he wants to get in before the tribunal. He wants to show, he wants to make this person look bad, but it has no direct relevance. The only way is, the trouble is common law court sometimes are generous. And the counsel will tell the judge, what I want to do, I know it's not directly relevant, but I want to show that this is a person of bad character. This is a person who has told lies before. This is a person whose evidence you should not believe. And I have to do that by showing you that he constantly lies. In arbitration, we just don't have time for that. You compress 3 weeks of common law trial into 5 days, all of this is luxury. And you say, unless it's really, really relevant to this particular case, most tribunals are not going to allow this, we shouldn't allow this. And that's not the way that we expect efficient commercial arbitration to be done. Six is a little bit similar, trying to break the witness down into admitting facts, either on construction of the documents or matters of law. Again, that's counsel's role. Don't waste the time of the tribunal getting witnesses, because it gets back to opinion, it gets back to these are not the people who should be answering those questions. Now, the last one is interesting, and I want to just make sure that I get agreement from the people in this room, because most of you are civil law trained. What I'm saying in number 7 is definitely correct for common law, because common law believes in the objective theory of the contract. Meaning, when you interpret a contract, you do not look into the subjective minds of each of the parties. You look into what words they use to conclude the contract, and how a hypothetical, reasonable third party, listening or reading the words that were exchanged between two parties, would conclude what they had agreed. So you don't go and ask him, what did you intend when you use these words? That question is absolutely irrelevant from a common law point of view. Now, of course, I know that in theory, in civil law, you are supposed to ascertain the actual intention of the parties. But I've said many times with civil law trained co-arbitrators, they don't really want to go and penetrate into the mind. They also start with the same way of investigating the contract. Look at the written word. What did they use? What are the words they use? If they use these words, we don't really are not interested in what other intention they had in their mind when they use the words. And this is especially true, I suggest to you, whether you're civil law or common law, is what was in your mind when you used this word? It's a completely useless question, because unless you have a second question, and did you tell the other party this is what you want? Because if you never told the other party what your intention was, there's no way that you can say this was a common intention. You can only rely on the actual words they use. We can have a little bit of a discussion about that. I'm waiting to be educated by you. But from what my own experience is, sitting with civil law arbitrators, we never seem to have a difference about how to interpret a contractual situation in that way. So that's why, again, I don't think this is helpful for cross-examination. Now, this is where I tell you, look at the back of the slides for the full list of 21. Of course, there's a little bit of repetition here. The QC getting more and more frustrated. So it's just to show that even the so-called masters of the art in cross-examination can do it in a very inefficient way that gets you nowhere. So let me try and sum up at this point. The proper use of cross-examination is actually quite limited. Sometimes you need to challenge credibility. Where there is a real issue of fact and the witness says something which really your side doesn't accept as being true, and then there is some effort has to be made to try and break that down or persuade the tribunal that there are inconsistencies. But again, when I was doing this kind of work, I would try and find inconsistencies in the record. And if there are inconsistencies in the record, then I would bring it back into the opening statement again. If you can see inconsistencies from, let's say, his witness statement and letters in the hearing bundle, which the tribunal probably won't have read, then you straight away say, why is it that we think that our case is stronger than theirs, or why our case is more believable than theirs? It's because you can see in paragraph 3 of witness statement A, the witness says this, but look at that document at page 250 of the hearing bundle. It completely contradicts it. It's up to him to explain. Now, then you push the burden onto the other side. Either they keep quiet, in which case your point goes unchallenged, or when they call that witness, then they'll have to say, well, you know, you heard counsel say that there is an inconsistency. What is your response? So he will give some excuse. Once he gives that excuse, or he gives that rationalization, then you go in and cross-examine again. So, you know, he will have to make something up, and at that point, then you get another chance. Then that is where the real cross-examination, the real value of cross-examination will come in. But the whole point is you throw the burden onto the other side. Make them do the running. And sometimes, it's quite straightforward. You have a theory of the case, but you need a few, there are a few gaps. And you really need information. You don't need to challenge anybody. So a witness comes, the information is with him, you cross-examine him simply to get information. And then you fill in the gaps in your own case from there. That's straightforward. But that can be valuable because otherwise you may have a hole in your theory. But I come back to the point that making a witness look bad isn't a worthwhile exercise by itself. And the reason why I say that is because when you try to make somebody look bad by a small thing like a single letter, it distorts the importance of that letter to the theory of the case. You can only, I mean, you take half an hour to try and make the witness confused or make the witness agree that what he said in the letter wasn't correct. But A, you could probably get there without even having to cross-examine. But B, if you took that half hour and spent time in examining five more documents in the chain of documents that you had to explain to the tribunal, there's probably more benefit to your overall case in spending time on five documents instead of just one, simply because of the limited time that you have in commercial arbitration. And as I said, I don't want to say that cross-examination is never important. These are the cases where you do need to cross-examine at some length. When your client thinks that there's fraud, let's say an employee has run off with money or has done something dishonorable, which justify sacking him, and that's the issue. You know, if it becomes an employment dispute and you go to arbitration, then of course you have to cross-examine and try and expose the person for having actually been guilty of a serious crime or a lesser offense. Basically crime or fraud or dishonesty. And the second point I think I've referred to is when there are things that you want to challenge, then you challenge them straight up. at the beginning, and then wait for him to come back. Wait for the witnesses being put to the challenge to try and explain away something which you have already identified as being a weak link in his lecture. Now, the final point where cross-examination is actually quite important is when you are talking about experts, because that's a whole different area, and each expert will come, and obviously it's not easy at the beginning on day one to say, we have an expert who says this causation of, let's say, there's been a collapse of a building, and my expert says that it's due to bad engineering, and that's why we're suing this engineering firm. But their engineering expert says, no, it was bad design, so it's not their fault. It's very difficult on day one to try and compare the two expert reports, because usually counsel will not have that expertise to be able to convincingly persuade the tribunal on their own which expert should be accepted. So that you have to push off to the end, and either you have to cross-examine each expert in the traditional way, or these days what we do is witness conferencing, the so-called hot tubbing. And basically what you are using, what technique you're using is, if you don't agree with the other side's expert, you get your expert to be the one breaking down. If your expert cannot break the other side's expert, then you can't either. And so you have to leave it to your expert to defend your side point of view, hopefully, and the other side to be demonstrated to be wrong, and your expert's report to be accepted instead. So, the final conclusion, we should focus on the opening statement, both the written as well as the oral. We should limit our cross-examination only to absolutely necessary questions. And third, we should use the closing statement as a supplement to the opening statement and not to be the grand statement of all time. The basic rationale for this, trying to get your side's credibility up there with the tribunal from day one rather than from day five. I'm happy to take questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very insightful presentation.